Welcome everyone to the seventh meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received apologies for today's meeting from Sue Webber, and no substitute member is attending in her place. Our first item is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you, colleagues. We're agreed. And our second item is a further evidence session with Scottish Government ministers as part of our inquiry into the health and wellbeing of children and young people. A welcome to the committee for the first time in this session, Shona Robertson, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. Claire Hawkey also attending this committee for the first time in this session, Minister for Children and Young People, and they're supported by Fiona Clements, Improving Lives for People with Care, Experienced Units, the Children's and Families Directorate, Gavin Henderson, the Deputy Director of Keeping the Promise, Shirley Lang, the Director for Housing and Social Justice, Tom McNamara, the Head of Youth Justice and Children's Hearings, and Laura Meikle, the Head of Support and Wellbeing Unit for the Scottish Government. They are on joining us online. Welcome to you both. I believe, Cabinet Secretary, you've got an opening statement to make.
Yes, thanks, Convener, if that's okay.
Yes.
Good morning, everyone, and I'm very grateful to the committee for inviting myself and the Minister to give evidence today. The COVID pandemic has obviously had a clear impact on the wellbeing of children and young people, and the true extent of that will not yet be evident, and that's why this committee's inquiry is so important and why this government remains committed to getting it right for every child. We know that there are strong links between experience of poverty in childhood and poorer health outcomes across a range of measures, and not only that, there are impacts on wider life chances, including on educational attainment. We want better for Scotland's children and have set in statute ambitious income-based targets to significantly reduce levels of child poverty in Scotland by 2030, and have declared tackling child poverty as a national mission, working to mobilise all of Scotland to drive the progress that's needed. Across the life of our first Tackling Child Poverty delivery plan, we have strengthened the financial support available for low-income families across the early years. And this includes through our package of 5 family benefits, including our Best Start Grant, Best Start Foods and the Scottish Child Payment, a package which will further strengthen from April with a doubling of the Scottish Child Payment to £20 per week per child. We now offer the equivalent of 1,140 early learning and childcare hours to all 3- and 4-year-olds and around a quarter of 2-year-olds, a critical investment in both children and parents. And we have delivered new employment support built on the values of dignity and respect, providing the help parents need to access employment without fear of sanctions. We recognise that holistic whole family support is essential to wellbeing and tackling poverty. And to this end, we have committed to investing £500 million of the whole family wellbeing funding over the course of this Parliament. We also recognise the additional challenges faced by our care experienced children and young people. And by the end of this parliamentary year at the latest, we'll publish a single implementation plan that will set out the actions and commitments that we will deliver to ensure that we keep the promise by 2030. We'll also publish our next Tackling Child Poverty delivery plan by the end of March. And this will set out the transformational actions that we'll take with partners across Scotland to tackle child poverty and drive progress toward the ambitious targets set by this parliament. In 2021, our investment targeted at low-income households reached almost £2.5 billion, including nearly £1 billion focused on low-income families with children. Delivering on our ambitions on child poverty and child wellbeing will require not only changes in the ways of working, but also in investment, and that's why our ongoing resource spending review has outlined child poverty as a key priority. So I welcome the committee's inquiry and the opportunity for the Minister for Children, Young People and myself to answer the committee's questions relevant to our portfolios.
Thank you very much. And it's important to say that, I mean, we've asked ministers and cabinet secretaries from across different portfolios, because what they're doing feeds into children's health. And the amount of stakeholders and witnesses that we've had who flagged up poverty as being the driver of poor mental and physical health outcomes for children and young people was overwhelming, and that prompted us to bring both of you in. So thank you for coming and giving us that your perspective on the work that you're doing. I just want to ask the Cabinet Secretary about interim child poverty targets and where you are on that, but also what the challenges are in the, I suppose, the constitutional landscape and the powers landscape of tackling poverty from the Scottish Government perspective.
So, I mean, first of all, I think we have made considerable progress in implementing the first delivery plan that includes key supports that I mentioned earlier on, including the child Scottish Child Payment for children under six and the bridging payments for older children and the parental employability support. So we're not starting from nothing. There are building blocks there. But I think we recognised that we needed to make the next delivery plan far more cross-government. We can't tackle child poverty through social security alone. It can do some of the heavy lifting, but you also have to try and reduce costs, and you have to try and increase opportunities for employment, because we know that work is a key way out of poverty and child poverty for families. So to do that requires the whole of government to be focused on this. It also requires partnerships across the rest of Scotland, with local government, with third sector, with the private sector as well, to make that happen. So the focus is very much around those three pillars and what we can bring across the whole of government in pulling that together. I've spent a lot of time in bilateral meetings with colleagues. We've spent a lot of time at Cabinet discussing this, and we are looking at every possible way that we can make those interim targets achievable. Now, that is against quite a challenging backdrop. It's against a challenging backdrop of the cost of living pressures that are building. It's against a challenging backdrop of the cut to universal credit of the £20 pandemic uplift that had been given, and that has caused problems. So we are doing absolutely everything we can, but I don't think I can underestimate that is against a very, very difficult backdrop. But we need to get this right, and we absolutely need to give our children the best chance of having the life chances that they absolutely deserve. So we're working hard.
Can I ask about the approach that you're taking to the forthcoming delivery plan and the work that you've done with stakeholders to inform that plan? I know it's a huge question, but just to give us a grounding, because a lot of my colleagues are going to come in on the specific aspects of it later on.
Yeah, so I think we started from the point of view that we don't have all the answers. We have some ideas, but we don't have all the answers, and that's why we've been consulting with a wide range of stakeholders, seeking to build on the robust evidence base established during the life of the first delivery plan. And clearly we've also sought views directly from the Social Justice and Social Security Committee as the principal committee with the remit, expertise and oversight of this work, but very much welcome the views of other committees and indeed the third sector organisations, local government, and those with lived experience as well. So we've been working with the Poverty Commission, who have also in turn been working with those with lived experience to try and co-develop and test some policy proposals in advance of publishing the plan next month. And I think those really has looked at how we support the six priority families. We know that the six priority families account for around 90% of all children in poverty in Scotland. So we know that if we can do better by them and come up with solutions that are going to work for those families, that we can really dig deep into child poverty. So we've been looking at, so on the employability side, for example, we've been really thinking about how do we create more bespoke solutions for families? Because if they had already found it easy to navigate and get into employment from the position they're in, they would have already done so. So we need to understand the barriers. Some of those barriers are financial, but some of them are about childcare, some of them are about transport and costs. And we need to understand that and try to wrap around solutions that are going to make the difference and open doors that have previously been closed. And we also need to look at the costs that families face and how we can reduce those in the current climate of increasing living costs, and importantly making sure that people are getting the support that they are entitled to through Social Security Scotland. So that is the approach that we're taking, and I'm very hopeful that it will give us the best chance possible of meeting those interim targets.
Before I bring my colleague Sandesh in, who wants that, I just wanted to bring in the Minister, because a lot of the approach in tackling the well-being of children and young adults has been very early interventions and significant interventions, both universal and bespoke. Could you give us an overview of that from your portfolio perspective?
Yeah, of course, and thanks very much, Convener, for the opportunity to speak to the committee. So if you look at overall the work that Scottish Government does with their partner agencies and health, looking at right through from preconceptual care, antenatal care, perinatal care, the baby box, the Best Start grants that are available to families, looking at giving our children and our families the absolute best start in life, giving them the tools and the opportunities to have healthy babies and to be supported when they do become a family, when someone gives birth to a child. One of, I suppose, the most obvious examples is the baby box, which is Scottish Government introduced in the programme for government in 2016, and I think that if you look at that as a universal measure, you know, there's as of January this year, there were over 200,000 baby boxes delivered across Scotland, having an impact on 98% of expectant parents who took up that offer of support, of clothing, of information, and I think that demonstrates how valued that particular intervention, that particular offering is. But obviously, you know, moving on then, looking at the expansion of childcare, early learning childcare, in August last year, all local authorities were offering 1140 hours of free early learning and childcare across Scotland, and obviously, as the Cabinet Secretary alluded to there, that offer is also there to eligible two-year-olds as well, and we're looking as a government to expanding some of that offer, which we hope will impact on some of the effects on families of poverty that the Cabinet Secretary alluded to there about being able to access work and training and education through the use of some of that free childcare provision. In addition to that, in the manifesto for government, we're also looking at expanding that childcare offer, looking at wraparound childcare, out-of-school childcare and holiday childcare as well. So providing families with some of the support that, as the Cabinet Secretary says, we do think is needed in terms of enabling some of those families to access some of the services, some of the education and some of the work opportunities to alleviate the poverty that they find themselves in.
Thank you very much. Can I bring in Sandesh Gohani?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Welcome, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm glad that you mentioned work as an exit route from poverty. So my question is, why do low-income parents lose their council tax reduction when they enter work rather than a gradual tapered withdrawal to incentivise work? And Cabinet Secretary and Minister, you both mentioned childcare, but the Joseph Rowntree Foundation said in 2020 less than 30% of local authorities had enough childcare on a background of huge council tax funding decreases. So what work will the Scottish Government do to improve this?
So our council tax reduction scheme currently protects over 470,000 low-income households in Scotland from council tax bills, according to need and ability to pay. And there's obviously no equivalent in England, where council tax support was localised to individual local authorities from 2013. So that our council tax reduction scheme has maintained support since the abolition of council tax benefit in 2013, and it is, the funding for it has actually exceeded local authority costs by over £97 million over the past 3 years. So, I mean, I think I would say that we are doing what we can around those costs. Clearly, the government at the moment is looking at how we support families with some of the consequential monies that have come from UK government's response to cost of living, and Cabinet is considering that at the moment. So we will always look at what more we can do, and the budget, we have tried to really balance and focus in on how we support low-income households at a time of rising costs. We can't do everything, and we can't mitigate every single aspect of decisions made elsewhere, but what we can do is to try and focus that support as best we can. I don't know, Claire, do you want to answer on the childcare?
On childcare, yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. So we've made significant progress in delivering a major expansion of funded early learning and childcare over recent years. We work very closely with COSLA, with our local authority colleagues, and with the PVI sector in expanding that offer of free childcare. There's been significant investment in infrastructure, some expansion of nurseries, some new builds of nurseries to be able to afford that offer to local communities. So I think you know, we've proven that when we set targets, we can meet those in terms of providing early learning and childcare. There are obviously other, we have a provider neutrality in terms of funding, so that as outside of actual nursery buildings, obviously the child minding industry offers a huge offer to children and to young people, both preschool, early years, and in school, wraparound school care. So obviously there is always work to do in terms of supporting that infrastructure, supporting that industry, and ensuring that there will be places for the children when we expand that childcare offer.
Bring in Emma Harper, who joins us remotely. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Minister Bohi. I'm interested in issues around child poverty and public health. To what extent is child poverty viewed as a public health issue?
There are absolutely clear links between the experience of child poverty and poorer health outcomes across a range of measures over the course of a child's life, including healthy life expectancy. And as I said earlier, our approach has been to make sure we are working right across government, and that includes those working within the health portfolio area and what they can bring to the table. Claire Hawkey talked earlier on about that early intervention and some of the work to get that right in terms of making sure that the interventions are the right ones. And I think the target set through the Child Poverty Act allows us to look holistically across a wide range of action to tackle child poverty. So I think when you look at some of the work that Harry Burns has done, for example, he's very much set poverty and child poverty in the public health context. To basically, the challenge to us all is not to see poverty and child poverty as inevitable, but actually a product of society and the structures in society, and therefore we need to understand that in order to really help move those barriers and structural issues that set children on a path towards poverty as soon as they're born. Now, we have some of the levers to address that. One of the frustrations is we don't have them all, and sometimes the work we do and the decisions we make feel sometimes that there's a pushback from decisions made elsewhere. And I mentioned the universal credit £20 cut earlier on, and so that can be a difficulty. But we have to use every lever we have as a government and to try and make progress on child poverty. But I think viewing it as a public health issue is the right thing to do.
Thank you. Emma?
Thanks. Just to pick up on the baby boxes that Minister Claire Hawkey mentioned as well, I think you mentioned 200,000 baby boxes have been given so far, and I know that Dumfries and Galloway had 1,241 and NHS Borders had 1,033. And so are you able to tell us a wee bit about the impact of the introduction of baby boxes and how has that helped support to protect or to do some of the challenges against some of the poverty that we're seeing?
Thanks to Emma Harper for that question. So the independent evaluation of Scotland's baby box was published last year on the 13th of August, and that highlighted the positive impact of the scheme on families, particular for first-time, younger and low-income parents, with a 97% satisfaction with the box and its contents, and 91% of families reported financial savings, which I think is obviously very relevant to the committee's inquiry just now. The evaluation also highlighted key impacts, including saving money on essential items needed for the baby, as well as learning about positive parenting behaviours, such as learning to bond with the baby through playing, talking and reading. And over half of the families reported reading to their baby earlier as a result of receiving the baby box, which obviously is good for promoting that attachment, that positive parenting, and also for child development, particularly in speech and language, as we know that reading to younger children can help them to develop those skills, which is really important. So I think we've demonstrated through that research, and I think also through the uptake, the parental uptake of the baby box, how valued that is. If I could pick up a little bit on what the Cabinet Secretary had said there about us having to mitigate some of the impacts of decisions made elsewhere with reserved benefits. The benefit cap that was introduced by the Westminster government a few years ago, we saw statistics in the last couple of weeks about the number of children that have been affected by that benefit cap. So essentially their families not being paid for or not receiving benefits for more than two children. And in my own constituency, at least 215 children have been affected by that. So the impact of that on family incomes is huge. And that's in one constituency in Scotland. So I think we really have to look at the effects of child poverty and what the Scottish Government can do. And yes, we're not powerless. We can do things to alleviate child poverty, but at a time that we are, it feels like fighting with one hand tied behind our back. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Emma, have you got any more questions, or will I move on?
I'm quite happy for you to move on, Convener. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And can I come to questions on protection of vulnerable children from Gillian Mackay? Gillian.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning both. Given the difficulties the pandemic caused around keeping in contact with children and their families, as well as the decreased visibility of children during lockdown, is there a risk that a greater number of children will have fallen through the cracks and not been identified by public services as vulnerable or at risk? And what action has been taken to identify those children?
Claire, do you want to...
I can certainly start on that. So, you know, obviously, we're acutely aware of the impact that the pandemic has had on all of us and particularly on children and families. So the COVID-19 Children and Families Collective Leadership Group, which was jointly chaired by Scottish Government and SOLIS, was established in May 2020 to bring together national and local government and other partners across children and family services, and that included health, education, justice, third sector, to review concerns for children, young people and families with vulnerabilities during the pandemic and the longer term support for recovery and renewal. And as part of its work during the pandemic, the CLG developed an action plan focused on 10 priorities, including access to services, child protection, drug and alcohol, care leavers, respite care and workforce resilience. And so using near real-time data rather than historic data, the CLG was able to get a better sense of the early impact on vulnerable children, including commissioning deep dives through CELSIS, who I believe the committee has had some contact with and received some information from and some evidence, as well as other partners to understand the collective impact and any emerging trends, particularly around service response to need. We've learned to work over the course of the pandemic in a more agile way between national and local government organisations and agencies, and obviously the need to continue to be inclusive of our third sector partners. And this has been largely driven by better access to timely routine data and the use of local intelligence, which wasn't previously available in that way. We've seen some really good examples of how services have adapted to the pandemic to ensure that they're able to deliver to particularly vulnerable children and families. I've heard some examples of social workers donning PPE to go in and do home visits, meeting up with children and families outside, going for a walk at times when that was the most appropriate and the most safe given the mitigations that were in place for COVID-19. And of course, health services remained operational during even the most restrictive of the restrictions and lockdown in terms of maternity services were prioritised, health visitors, school nurses remained working too. So there certainly are lessons to be learned, and we will learn from them that if services need to respond to tighter restrictions that need to be put in place in future, that we can learn from the work that's already been done and the research.
That's great, thank you. The Promise has commented on the impact of the National Care Service proposals on reform of the care system. How do we ensure that reform and change is happening now while long-term work on the National Care Service is ongoing?
Do you want me to take this one?
If you
that's fine, that's absolutely fine. So the I'm sure the committee heard some evidence last week on the National Care Service from my colleague Kevin Stewart, who's leading on that, and I believe this week the responses to the call for evidence and the consultation will be published, and so I don't want to preempt any of that. Obviously, children's services were included in that consultation, and I know that a wide variety of views will have been submitted just through my conversations with stakeholders and others. But as a government, we're absolutely committed to keeping the promise and ensuring that children in Scotland grow up feeling loved, safe and respected, and that the care services that they receive are appropriate to them and that they're wraparound services. So there, I have no doubt that there will be, with the introduction of a National Care Service, there will be challenges ahead. There's inevitably going to be changes to social work, even if it's only adult services that are within the National Care Service. But we're very mindful of that. The commitment to the promise is like the challenges of child poverty, is a cross-government commitment. We would be very mindful of how unintended impacts and working through how the National Care Service would be developed so that we don't see unintended consequences to other parts of systems or services.
That's me, Convener, thanks.
Can I bring in Paul Kane?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Minister. I think just following on perhaps on that previous question about the promise, last week Louise Hunter, the Chief Executive of Who Cares Scotland, referred to progress on the promise as, and I quote, implementation purgatory. So given what the Minister has just said about the length of time it's going to take in terms of the process for a National Care Service, and I think what is perceived in the sector as delay to implementation of the promise, does the Minister think that's a fair assessment?
Do you know, I can understand why care experienced people feel frustrated that progress isn't as visible as it should be. The last 2 years have been very difficult and challenging for all of us, and many people's situations have changed as a result of that. As we recover from the impact of COVID-19, our commitment to keep the promise remains central to our actions as a government, as I released in my answer to Gillian Mackay. And our ambition to create the conditions that enable wellbeing to flourish are set out in our COVID recovery strategy, and that includes driving forward the changes that we need to keep the promise.
I was going to ask, we heard from quite a few care-experienced young adults, some of them actually becoming parents themselves, and they talked about the situation that they were in the pandemic, being very, very isolated. And out of that came a very astute comment from young woman. I think I mentioned this to Kevin Stewart last week, where she said that, like, local authorities all know who's leaving care, who they are, and when that happens. Yet the outcomes for young people leaving care and get into their adult life in terms of their health and mental well-being are known to be quite bad. And she made the point that the local authorities almost seem to leave them, and there's nothing in place for them in terms of their mental health. I mean, I just wonder what your response would be to that, because it seemed to be a very astute comment. And obviously, not every local authority, they act independently of one another, and they act differently. What are we doing to make sure that young people leaving care or having care experience have better outcomes in terms of their health and well-being?
It sounds like the voice of that young woman has obviously resonated with yourself, Convener, and I'm sure with the rest of the committee. And it's vitally important that we listen to those voices, and that we have those voices and that experience at the heart of the work that we do. And I know obviously that's vitally important as we develop policy and as we work to fulfil the promise that the voice of lived experience is there. We absolutely recognise the vital role of positive and well-planned transitions, and that they can have that planning can improve the outcomes for young people in care and leaving care. We're committed to supporting care experienced young people who are in care and leaving care, and that's enshrined in the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, and in the measures that we are taking to keep the promise. We are working with partners to explore how we link existing data collections together to provide a clearer picture of health and well-being outcomes for care-experienced young people to enable us to make targeted interventions. And as an example of that being over the course of the next 6 to 12 months, we're working with 4 local authorities on a pilot programme to link CHI numbers with existing looked-after children data to provide a better understanding of outcomes and give us the information for next steps for a national rollout, so that ultimately we're able to get a better understanding of long-term outcomes, and also to measure improvements in the care system as we work together to keep the promise and improve the lives of children and young people. So there certainly is work ongoing there, but through that work has to be that golden thread of lived experience and of people's experience, good and bad, being in looked after situations or in the care system, and what we can take from that they felt was good and what we need to improve on. But we're absolutely determined to do that.
Thank you. Can I go back to Paul? You want to talk about child poverty priority groups, Paul?
Thank you, convener. I suppose having read the information on this, I just wanted to maybe start with how the data can perhaps be improved to really look at intersectionality. So, for example, how do we know how many families who are from an ethnic minority background also have children who have a disability? So I think just how do we drill down essentially and get to the detail of what are very complex and different lives?
Yeah, I think you raise an important point. As I said earlier, we've placed a sharp focus on 6 priority families, but of course those families are all different in their challenges. So how do we make sure that we understand all of those challenges? And we've published a series of evidence reviews alongside our first 3 annual child poverty progress reports, one on lone parents, one on BAME families, and one on disability. And I think we need to not take a one-size-fits-all approach. So I mentioned earlier on about more bespoke solutions for families. I mean, each family is different from each family, but those with different protected characteristics clearly have further challenges. So on the data, it's always going to be difficult to pick up small populations within sample surveys. And therefore, it's important to support sample surveys with the development of other evidence and qualitative and, I guess, what would be called participatory research with the priority families, I think, is really key to understanding barriers and what works in tackling poverty for them. So those additional reports, I think, will help us do that. And we're actively looking to develop data linkage to allow better analysis of those small populations. And the Data Intelligence Network has an ongoing project to link the census, the school pupil census and health records. And I think if that is able to be done, it would provide a kind of more granular level of information. So I guess, though, having said all of that, one of the most important things we can do is to listen to what families are telling us are the barriers. So if you think about those 3 pillars that I mentioned earlier on, when it comes to employability, for example, those who are one of the parents has a disability, or the parents are from the BAME community, they're going to face additional barriers to employment for all of the reasons that we understand than perhaps other families, lone parent families. Likewise, if they're overcoming those childcare barriers and the other barriers that they will face. So we need to understand that, and our solutions in the delivery plan need to recognise that one size doesn't fit all, and getting alongside families and working with them with trusted folk who know the families rather than, you know, pitching in with a kind of an agency to say, you know, we want to speak to you. I think that kind of trusted, quite often third sector organisations can help to have a conversation about what would make the difference to your family in helping you to move on to the world of work, to overcome some of the issues that you have.
Thank you, convener. It was a comprehensive answer from the Cabinet Secretary, and actually began to, I think, explore some of the further themes that I'm keen just to get a wee bit more clarity on. So, I think quite rightly the Cabinet Secretary says that a one-size-fits-all approach doesn't work. The government's intention then to target measures specifically at the groups that we've just discussed. Is there examples at the moment of initiatives where that targeting is happening?
So I think on the last question, I think there are, in that there is a lot of kind of third sector support that's wrapped around, you know, particularly focused on lone parents, for example. And, you know, there are specific supports that, particularly again through third sector organisations, for black and minority ethnic families. But I think we could do better at understanding the barriers, particularly on employability. And also, there's evidence that there's still perhaps families who are not as aware of the supports that are available that they're entitled to. So we need to understand why that is and overcome those barriers to actually accessing financial support that is there that they're entitled to. And there are other issues, for example, about whether or not we are, through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, are we building enough homes for families that require, you know, 4 or 5-bedroom homes. I think we could be better at that. And obviously keeping then the cost of a home through the social rented sector is substantially less than through the private rented sector. So we need to think about how we reduce costs as well. But the employability, I think, area is one that is underdeveloped and is a really strong focus for us in this delivery plan, because I think we recognise that if we're actually going to help families move into the world of work, we need to understand the barriers for all of those families, and they will be different from one family to another. So trying to tailor that support to families to meet their particular needs, if we can do that in a more effective way, I think we could really begin to help families. So we're looking at some test sites at the moment around how can we test that out, and working with families to look what works. So a lot of work is going on around that at the moment, and happy to furnish the committee with more information about that once it's live to go.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you.
If I might just give one further example of a targeted support from my own portfolio interests. So the eligibility of 2-year-olds to access the 1140 years was expanded to children of care-experienced parents, to obviously provide them with the opportunities of being able to work, train, continue or restart education, but also a recognition that they may not have the family support round about them that other people may have in terms of childcare, in terms of getting some time away, or being able to, you know, being able to have their children in a safe place so that they can access other services. So I think that's another example of where we've targeted some of that support that's quite tangible.
Can I pick up on something that, I mean, we're talking about the 1140 hours and the expanded care to vulnerable 2-year-olds. I mean, what, particularly given we've just had the lockdowns and issues there with not being able to access some of that care that ordinarily would. What's been done, Ms Hawkey, to improve the uptake of the places that people with twos that are entitled to additional childcare, they can take them up? Because I think that's... There might be families out there, there might be parents out there that they don't want to put their two-year-old into nursery. Is there a flexibility of provision that you're seeing that's maybe encouraging the take-up?
So there is a principle of provider neutrality. So a parent who has an eligible child would be able to use an early learning setting that could be childminding, it could be a nursery placement, it could be an outdoor nursery. You know, there's a variety of settings that parents can choose. I think it's important to remember that even during the school closures, for most pupils and ELC closures for most young people, that those facilities were there for our key workers, absolutely, to maintain services, but also for vulnerable families who were identified, so that local authorities identified the families that they know best, obviously. So they were still able to access that funded ELC and school age care. But I think, yeah, although we have, I think as I said in my answer to Sandesh Gulhani earlier, we've made significant progress in delivering a major expansion and part of that during a pandemic. So it's testament to the work that has been done by many people to ensure that we could deliver 1140 in August last year. We've seen an uptake in the number of eligible twos in terms of year on year, which is encouraging. But obviously there is still more to do, and we want to ensure that everyone who is eligible for that provision is able to access it if they choose, accepting that there will be some parents of two-year-olds who don't want to use that childcare. Some of the work that we've done is to ensure that people's services who are in contact with those families are aware of the offer, and that they're able to inform families of the offer of childcare. We're working with the UK government to look at the UK level data sharing. There's actually a consultation currently out from the UK government calling for views about data sharing with Scottish Government. The families who are recipients of those eligible benefits, so that local authorities are better able to communicate directly with those families, as there's been issues with GDPR and systems not being able to speak with each other. So my understanding is that will require some legislation from Westminster, but that consultation is currently there. And I think we also need to, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we need to get alongside those families and understand what are some of the barriers there to eligible families accessing that childcare offer that's currently there.
Thanks. Sandesh, you were saying you want to come in on that, but you're able to go into your theme as well, which is on the development of children during COVID.
Thank you, Convener. And just before I do come into theme five, Minister, you talked about the uptake, but actually between 2019 and 2020, registrations fell from 11% to 2%. And the Scottish Childminding Association have said that added bureaucracy and paperwork for childminders has stopped them from delivering the funded 1140 hours and led many to leave the profession or prevented new people from joining. Just wondering what your response would be to that.
Well, my figures are slightly different to yours in that, yes, there was a drop between 2019 to 2020, but it was a drop from 11% to 9% rather than 2%. And it increased to, in 2021, to 13%. I think given the impact of COVID, there could be some understanding for why perhaps parents didn't register their children for that eligible childcare, or perhaps were reluctant to do so, given, you know, the circumstances that they were living in. The Childminders and Childminders Association are absolute key partners with Scottish Government and local authorities in delivering 1140 and looking at developing the sort of wraparound care that that we've committed to doing. And so we've been working very closely with Child Minders and Child Minders Association to understand why child minders are giving up their profession, to try and help to recruit and retain some of those, and they are an absolute key part of the ELC workforce. So we're committed to doing that and working alongside the National Association to understand what attracts people to becoming child minders, to ensuring that it is seen as an attractive career option, and to expanding that workforce, but also to retaining the workforce and understanding why people choose to leave.
Minister. So just moving on to theme five. So Mary Glasgow told the committee that there are babies and toddlers who are reluctant to go to nursery or begin to move through important social stages. And we will see the impact of COVID for some time to come. And the University of Glasgow found 10 to 13% of children had a concern about one area of development. And these included gross motor, speech and language, and emotional and behavioural development. So, Cabinet Secretary, what impact assessment did the Scottish Government make regarding later restrictions to the development of children?
I mean, it might be one for Claire's.
I'm happy to answer as a minister. So I spoke earlier on about some of the cross-sectoral work that we've done in terms of the Children and Families Collective Leadership Group, looking at the impact of the pandemic on children and young people, and looking at that real-time data and looking at how services were responding to children and young people and families. And, you know, I think it's important to remember that, and I'm sure you'll be aware, that the early years workforce, including ELC and health visiting and allied health professionals, continued to support parents and carers over the course of the pandemic. They might have been working in different ways. But we know that social and emotional development have been impacted over the course of the pandemic, and we'll continue to look at the controls and the measures in place to contain the pandemic and how they might need further adjustments so that they do minimise any developmental harm to our young people. We know that many children in Scotland have had a significant part of the nursery experience cut short due to COVID. And a key part of early learning is about children beginning to learn to socialise with others and learn group dynamics. And, you know, I think it's fair to say that lots of our wee ones have missed out on that, and the evidence is beginning to show the impact of the pandemic on a range of children's outcomes, as you alluded to, including speech and language development, which was one of the reasons why I highlighted it in terms of the baby box and the books in the baby box, and encouraging parents to read to their children, something that they can do at home that is so vital in terms of stimulating children's imagination, but also encouraging their speech and language development. So for all of those reasons, that's why we have prioritised keeping ELC and other vital services open with appropriate safety measures, and why we did prioritise the delivery of 1140, as I said, even though a lot of that planning was going on during the pandemic and a lot of that that development work was going there. We will continue to work with partners to support nurseries, to support primary schools and other services to help our young people and our young children to recover from the impacts of COVID. I know that the committee has heard evidence about the importance of play and how key that is to children's health and their well-being in terms of the ongoing recovery from COVID. In pre-COVID times, of course, it was vitally important too. So we've made a number of commitments in terms of the area of play, including a £60 million investment in renewing play parks. We invested heavily in outdoor play, which was obviously it was a safer environment for children to play in when they were outside, and we know that it helps to maintain their physical health, stimulates their imaginations, and they get lots of physical and mental benefits from being outside, and we supplied funding for clothing for nurseries, for example, last year to provide outdoor clothing for children who may not have that equipment. So to enable them to get outside too. We've invested in training for our ELC staff in terms of developing skills for playing outside. And we've seen a huge expansion in outdoor nursery provision, including in local authority and outdoor nursery provision. And I've been to see some of those facilities and see the impact that that has on children in terms of stimulating their imagination, helping them to develop and helping them to develop those skills and social interaction that they may not have had the opportunity to do during the COVID pandemic.
Thank you, Minister. And if you'll indulge me for my last question, sure. Convener. I was really happy to hear that you're looking at doing more. So at the start of your answer, you said that. So would you look to create a programme of social and emotional recovery focused activity as suggested by Mary Glasgow to this committee?
Well, obviously, we would look at all suggestions made by our third sector stakeholders, and we would look to embed social and emotional recovery right through all of our COVID recovery plans. I'm certainly happy to look at the evidence that Mary Glasgow gave. Children First are obviously a key stakeholder for Scottish Government and give us lots of advice and help in terms of developing policy. So we would certainly look at all of the evidence that the committee receives and the recommendations that the committee puts in their reports in terms of responding to your inquiry.
We'll move on to talking about the cost of living, the cost of living crisis as it's becoming. Shona Robertson, I imagine your inbox is as full as, you know, as a constituency MSP as mine is, with people very worried about heating their homes, about being able to feed their families. Can I ask what the Scottish Government's doing to try and help families get through this, and what I imagine you're having conversations cross-government about what can possibly be done to get families through this period of increased cost of living?
Yes, I mean, we absolutely are, and it features as a backdrop to all of the discussions we're having around the Child Poverty Delivery Plan and what we can do to support families. So let me just perhaps outline some of the areas that I think could make the difference. That's maybe also just worth repeating, actually, that during the previous period of time, which was tough due to the pandemic, we have focused a lot of support on low-income families. So in 2020-21, we invested around £2.5 billion to support low-income households, and nearly £1 billion of that directly supporting children. And we're committing more than £3.9 billion for benefit expenditure in 2022-23. That will provide support to over 1 million people. And actually, just to note that is over £360 million above the level of funding that we receive from the UK government through block grant adjustments. So this is money out with that we have put into supporting a benefit expenditure. So we've had to make those difficult choices, but I think trying to put as much money into people's pockets at the moment is important. We have, through that period of time, we provided direct financial support to over 500,000 households through the £130 pandemic support payment paid by the end of October last year. I mentioned the Scottish Child Payment, obviously doubling from April this year, which will benefit around 111,000 eligible under-6s. We're continuing investment in discretionary housing payments of £80 million, which includes around £68 million to fully mitigate the bedroom tax, which protects over 70,000 Scottish households. £41 million for the Scottish Welfare Fund. I announced a package over the winter in addition to all of that of £41 million for a winter support fund to help people heat their homes and to meet rising food costs, and that some of that has gone out through local government, some has gone out through third sector organisations. We're continuing to deliver the £520 bridging payments to over 143,000 children eligible for free school meals. And in addition to that, of course, we are looking at how we, as the First Minister said last Thursday, how we spend every penny of the additional consequentials reported to be around £290 million. To support people with escalating costs, and we want to do that in a way that helps the most vulnerable. So obviously the Secretary, Finance Secretary, will confirm plans for further investment during the final stages of the budget bill, but you know, we have looked at every way of trying to support people during these difficult times, and if there's more that we can do, then we will try to do it. But we are doing it obviously within a fixed budget. The areas of energy price regulation sit with the UK government. So what we are able to do is to focus our attention on household costs and financial support to people. And that's what we're trying to do. And I hope I've given a bit of a flavour of the...
As I'm listening to you, I'm thinking of the response that came from Rishi Sunak about giving loans. What did you think when you heard that, knowing what you do about vulnerable families on low incomes in Scotland? Is that a realistic or helpful suggestion?
I don't think it's targeted enough, and I think essentially people will have to pay that back over a period of time. I think, this is going to impact on a far wider range of people that are currently officially within the poverty statistics. More people who have just about been keeping their head above water are suddenly not going to be able to, and are going to be caught within the cost of living crisis. So our response has to be I think as targeted as it can to help those most impacted. I really fear for the ability of people being able to keep their heating on, put food on the table. So I think the support that we have already been focusing on, but will look to do more, has been really to try to make sure that we help those who need it most. But discussions are ongoing about what more we can do in that space. As I say, there'll be further information about that through the budget. Will we be able to mitigate every part of the cost of living impact? I don't think we can on a fixed budget. But what we can do is make sure our support is targeted at those who are most in need.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Gillian Mackay. She's got some questions on this.
Sorry, convener.
Can I just add something?
Sure.
Before, let Ms Mackay get to her questions.
Of course, Ms Hawkins.
Just for the committee's attention, as a precursor to the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, which we may well come on to later in the session, at the weekend, the Deputy First Minister announced £3 million to local authorities and £255,000 to a small number of third sector organisations to provide cash support to families who are currently in need. So there is an ongoing commitment to from government to do what we can when we can to
have that delivered locally.
Yes.
As you say, targeting people who
absolutely
who are
and
most need.
And really looking at targeting what families need at that point in time, whether that be help with utilities, help with clothing, help with food. Those sort of issues.
Thank you, that's helpful. Gillian.
Thank you. The writer Jack Munro has painstakingly documented not only rising prices in supermarkets, but shrinking product sizes and the reducing of value ranges. What conversations is the Scottish Government having with the retail sector about the impact of the reduction of value ranges, in particular on cost of living for lower income families?
I'm We'll come back to Gillian Mackay and the committee specifically on the discussions with retailers, but we have been engaging with the business sector generally around what they can do around costs. We've engaged with the energy sector, for example. I was in a meeting with Michael Matheson with the big energy companies to asking them what they're going to do around support to consumers. And obviously we've been calling on the UK government for urgent, tangible action against increasing energy bills. In terms of food costs, we have been supporting a number of initiatives around food poverty and working with a sort of trying to take a cash-first approach in supporting people and trying to, although food banks have done an amazing job, I think the food banks themselves and those who run the food banks have been supporting our strategy towards a cash-first approach, which becomes very important in the current climate. But you're right, retailers also have a responsibility, and supermarkets actually, their profits increased substantially during the pandemic, where perhaps other sectors that wasn't the case for. And therefore, I would certainly call upon them to do what they can to recognise that people are going to struggle to afford the increased prices of their food products, and they have an important role to play as well. And I'm happy to follow up on the detail of that with the committee.
That's great. Thank you.
Paul, you wanted to ask a question on this?
Thank you. Yeah, I suppose just quite a kind of technical question around Barnett consequentials. So essentially the Barnett consequentials from the UK council tax rebate in terms of cost of living. Just the most effective use of that. So what's the government's view on how that will be used? Are there plans in place?
Right, so I referred earlier on to discussions are still ongoing about the best way of utilising. I mean, obviously we already have a council tax reduction scheme in place, and we have had for a number of years, which ensures no one has to pay a council tax liability that they can't be expected to afford. That's not the case down south. So we've got something in place that essentially they're looking to do an element of. Our discussions are, as I say, ongoing around how can we make sure that money has the biggest impact on those who need it most. And those plans will be set out in short order in terms of how we will support families. And, you know, various options are being looked at, but the starting point is how can this have the biggest impact on those who are most in need would be the starting point for that discussion. We've also called, for example, for things that we think would have the biggest impact. So we've said a cut in VAT on energy bills would be one of the most simple means of helping energy consumers in the short term. So I think there are other levers that could be used more effectively. So we will looking at the options, and those will be announced in due course.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. And I'm going to bring in Carol Mawkins joining us online. Carol.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's very welcome that both the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary are indicating in this what is a crisis, we should be dealing with things that we can now. I'm interested to know their opinion on the low income winter heating assistance scheme is out for a consultation, but it's not penciled in to start till next winter. I wonder if they would agree with me that is in actual fact far too late, and I'd be interested to know what the discussions are around this in terms of what extent we're taking it into account the energy suppliers' views over that of those that actually need the assistance, as I think we are all agreed they need the assistance now.
Can I say, first of all, that there was a good chunk of the £41 million of the winter support package that I announced before Christmas has an element to help with fuel poverty through third sector organisations. So there is money going out the door to help people in the here and now. The new low-income winter heating assistance, as Carol Moken said, will replace cold weather payments with a guaranteed annual winter payment of £50 to around 400,000 low-income households, which will be an investment of £21 million in 2022-23. The UK government could make a payment to all those eligible for the cold weather payment right now. Clearly, we are moving to that new benefit as quickly as possible, but obviously COVID had an impact on our ability and the DWP's ability to expedite some of the new benefits in a way that we would have wanted. And that, unfortunately, was an impact of the pandemic, when a lot of that work was paused on both sides to focus on kind of life and limb support to people. We think the UK government can go further. I've already mentioned a cut on VAT on energy bills. We've urged the UK government to review the obligation costs on energy bills to reduce the premium paid by households reliant on electric heating and to help unlock the deployment of low and zero emissions heating. But you know, we don't have the powers for setting or changing energy tariff levels, but we are continuing to engage with Ofgem and discussing and urging UK government and energy suppliers to go further in the support that they can provide in a way that actually helps the most vulnerable. We also, I have to say, on the kind of medium to longer term, I'm sure the committee is aware of the significant investment, more than £1 billion, through energy efficiency programmes to make homes warmer and cheaper to heat. And that actually is quite important at the moment, as people face those rising energy costs. So we will continue to do what we can on energy and on food and on all of the other costs. Also worth mentioning, the Scottish Welfare Fund, which again had that additional monies put in through the winter support package, is a flexible fund that local authorities administer, and people can access that for payments for things that they are struggling with. And again, we've tried to put out information and through support structures, through welfare advice, through the National Helpline, to try and make sure that people can get access to the information that they need in order to find the right source of support that's out there.
Thank you. Can I move on to the theme of whole family support? And we have questions led by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. We've already heard the Cabinet Secretary this morning talking about getting alongside families and working with the people that families already work with, and that's often third sector. And also the Minister has spoken as well about the Deputy First Minister's announcements over the weekend as well. And I think, you know, that cash support for families is going to be really incredibly welcomed there. So we've heard an evidence too how crucial and critical it is that we're actually listening to families and that we're providing that hands-on and practical support that individual family needs. And also cash support and financial support is a part of that too there. It can really help stop families going off a cliff edge. So my question is, what guarantees can the Scottish Government give that funding for existing whole family support services will be maintained?
So maybe just to say a little bit first about the commitment to the £500 million whole family wellbeing fund. So this is obviously a new fund, and that's been prioritised within, you know, what is a tough budgetary envelope. But the impetus that we've talked about a lot already in this session around the need for early intervention and prevention rather than crisis intervention. And that fund is really to help what would need to be a sort of transformational shift towards those types of services. So the £50 million will be deployed in 2022-23 with really a focus on building the capacity for more significant investment from 2023-24 onwards. And it's a cross-portfolio budget. It's looking at how we provide that early support. The six priority families are obviously key here. And it really isn't about supporting business as usual and doing the same things. It is about enabling that shift in the way that we deliver family support services, and relates very much to Keep the Promise and other key strategies. So I think if we get that right, that will have a huge impact on how we can do things differently. We are, as I kind of said earlier on, that we are looking at how we support families through all of the budgets that I've outlined earlier on, in order to help families through what is going to be a really, really, really tough time. And again, if the committee would find it helpful, I can provide a kind of more detailed breakdown of all of the elements of the budget across portfolios that I think will help impact on money in people's pockets. I've given a flavour of some of that this morning, but happy to give a more comprehensive list if that's helpful.
Okay, so that's great. It's really reassuring to know that we're talking about moving forward, actually putting more and investing more in family support there. How are we actually going to measure the impact of the whole family wellbeing fund to really be able to drill down and make sure that it's supporting families?
So thanks very much to Stephanie Callaghan for that question. So we're working closely with the Promise Scotland and partners across local government, social justice, health and third sector to design and deliver the funding, and we're expanding our engagement to test ideas about where the funding will have the most sustained impact. Throughout all of that, as we spoke about earlier on, about having the voice of lived experience at the absolute heart of that, that we need to understand and reflect the opinions of families. That's absolutely crucial, and the experiences of those that help us to deliver family support to ensure that that it has the impact that we want it to have. We want this to be an ongoing process of learning and development over the course of the funding. And it's not the intention that we set in stone how the profile of the spending for the next 4 years is going to be. Rather, we want to listen, we want to learn from what can best support transformation and have the greatest impact for families, and allocate that funding accordingly. I wondered if it might be helpful now, convener, to perhaps ask one of the officials who's here with us.
Certainly.
Virtually to come in and perhaps give a bit more policy detail round about how we anticipate measuring the impact of the funding. So I would ask Gavin Henderson, who's the Deputy Director of Keeping the Promise, if he would like to expand on the answers given by myself and the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Mr. Henderson.
Convener, thanks very much, and thank you very much, Minister. Yes, as the Minister said, and the Cabinet Secretary has already said, we're planning to spend £50 million in 2022-23. And I should also mention that in working with the Promise Scotland, and as we set out in our programme for government, we're working towards an ambition of spending 5% of community health and social care spend by 2030 on preventative whole family support, and that's a significant increase in the funding even from that transformational spend. And as we work through the drafting of the implementation plan that the Minister announced a couple of weeks ago in Parliament, we'll be setting out how we plan to go about the monitoring and evaluation of that, whilst working with the Promise Scotland and other organisations on exactly the right monitoring and evaluation methods that we will require to make sure that we track and measure how we are properly keeping the promise. So that's the method we are proposing to take.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Stephanie?
That's great. Just one final question, convener, if that's okay.
Yes.
There. I'm wondering if there's some scope as well to expand the early intervention support for care experienced children specifically and their families, that goes beyond the whole family wellbeing fund. So I suppose relating back to the Promise to a degree too.
Do you want me to take this one too? So we're working with stakeholders to shape and design the whole Family Wellbeing Fund for 2022-23, as I'd said in the previous answer. And we recognise that early intervention is essential to ensure that children can safely remain in the care of their families when a child is at risk of becoming looked after or is looked after at home. And to fulfil our commitments to the promise, we have to understand the impact of trauma upon family relationships and how we can drive a reduction in this. And we'll continue to engage with stakeholders and listen to those with care experience to understand how we can support this critical work. Through the Children and Young People and Families Early Intervention Fund, which is more commonly known as CYPFEI, funding is provided to over 100 organisations, some of whom I'm sure the committee have received evidence from, to promote wellbeing, prevention and early intervention activities and improve parenting and family support. And we've committed to funding these organisations until 2023. And in April 2023, as committed to in this year's programme for government, we'll launch a £16 million third sector fund to replace the CYPFEI fund and the ALEX funds. So there is, there's ongoing commitments to continue to work with the sector.
Thank you. We now want to talk about housing policy, and we've got Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn's joining us online. Evelyn?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you both. Thank you for your answers so far. They've been really helpful. As a housing professional, I know that the Scottish Government has had a massive house building programme for a number of years. But why is it so important at present in terms of child poverty? And what are you doing to increase supply of housing at the present time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Very, very pertinent question. So we've committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent. And we've also committed to 10% being in more remote rural and island communities. So we've increased the total available for delivery of social and affordable homes in this parliamentary term. We've increased it to £3.6 billion. And that continued investment in social housing, I think, will ensure that even more people can access an affordable home, which will further drive down child poverty. So the links between affordable housing and child poverty are clear. Progress with the affordable housing delivery is reported through quarterly official stats publications, along with more detailed annual outturn reports. An estimated 2,100 households with children have been helped into affordable housing in the year to March 2021. And obviously, keeping social rents lower than market rents benefits approximately 110,000 children in poverty each year. We have for many years had the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, but it has become, I think, probably even more important as an investment that can also be seen as part of one of the levers to tackling child poverty. So good progress so far, more to be done. Obviously, there's been a COVID impact with construction having been paused for a period of time during the pandemic, and also construction costs and labour costs are very, very high at the moment, and that has impacted on the price of some projects coming through. But, housing associations and councils are working really, really, really hard to keep that pipeline of projects coming through so that we can keep the momentum going here. Also, there are other things that are quite innovative ways that local authorities and housing associations are operating, like off-market purchases, purchase from private sector developers, purchase on the open markets to try and meet the particular needs of families. So you know, there is a flexibility there to try to make sure that that we can meet needs. I mentioned earlier on the need for more larger homes, and also I think it would be fair to say we need to get better at making sure that homes are can meet the needs of people with disabilities and with complex needs, and I think there's more we can do in that space. And I'm keen to support housing associations and local authorities to get that right for folk. Housing to 2040 obviously laid out the vision of over the longer term to making sure that the standards are continually improving towards making sure that the more and more homes are barrier free and are more flexible as people's mobility changes over years. But I think there is more that we can do in that space to support people with particular complex needs, and we're looking at that at the moment.
Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, see, in terms of the house building programme, do you think Brexit has had an influence here and has dented the Scottish Government's programme, given what you've said about, you know, a lack of supply of materials, a labour shortage?
So I think together Brexit and the pandemic have created a perfect storm of increased material costs and getting materials from various parts of the world. The costs of that have increased, the shipping costs have increased, the raw materials have increased, labour costs have increased, and you put all that together and you can see the impact on goods and services across the board, and that the construction sector is no different from that. Now, there is a number of projects are still coming in under the agreed kind of benchmarks, and there is a bit of geographical variation, so we need to be very mindful of the fact that costs get higher the further north you go as well, because of economies of scale and a reduced number of contractors and so on and so forth. So we need to be mindful of that as well. So we've been through Minister Ivan McKee. He's been in regular dialogue with the construction sector to look at what we can do. But these are global issues. It's very difficult for the Scottish Government to change dramatically, but we are working with councils and RSLs to try and make sure we support them in keeping the momentum going.
Evelyn, are you happy for me to move on, or have you got any more questions? Thank you very much.
Could I have one more?
Yes, go on.
Sorry, thank you for your patience. How will a new deal for tenants target action on child poverty?
So clearly, strengthening tenants' rights. Obviously, tenants have rights and responsibilities, so that's the first thing we would all acknowledge. But strengthening tenants' rights around being able to, for example, on the affordability side, looking at appropriate controls on rent levels. And there's a consultation, obviously, out at the moment, which is important around how that's done. There is a variation across Scotland in terms of rent levels. We're sitting in a city where we recognise that the housing market within the Edinburgh area is very different from the housing market, both for rent and purchase, from other areas of Scotland. So when we look at rent controls, there has to be a recognition of different local circumstances. But, you know, affordability is important, and we need to make sure that people can afford rents. And the private rented sector is going to continue to have an important role to play. And, you know, there are... But we need to make sure that where we want to get to in Housing 2040 again set out this ambition that if we get this right, then we shouldn't there shouldn't really be any difference or visible difference between tenures if we can get the quality of standards and properties to the same level, if we can get the rights and responsibilities correct, if we can make sure that rents are affordable across all sectors, then you know we can drive up the quality of standards. And you know, good landlords have nothing to fear from these changes because you know many of them are already you know providing a good quality service to their tenants. So it's a package of measures.
Thank you very much. And we have a final theme on young adults. I know we've dipped into it throughout the session, but David Torrance is going to ask some questions on young adults.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Minister. How is the Scottish Government going to address poverty, or how are they focused on amongst young adults, especially young adults who can't live with their parents and are often affected mostly by poverty?
Do you want me to kick off? Yeah. So this is an important area, without a doubt. And let me just set out a few of the things that are hopefully relevant in this area. So we're continuing to invest in Young Persons Guarantee in making sure that young people have opportunities. So that the guarantee to provide a job, a place, an education or training, a formal volunteering opportunity for every young person. And there is an additional £45 million for this in 2022-23. From the end of January, nearly a million 5 to 21-year-olds living in Scotland will be eligible to benefit from free bus travel, which helps young people get connected to employment, training and obviously socially as well. We're also delivering our job start payment for young people to help with the cost of starting a job, and that's worth just over £252 for a single young person and over £400 if they're the main carer of any children. And we've helped around 1,800 young people with the cost of starting a new job through that. Young mothers are a particular focus as well, as one of the priority families that we talked about earlier on. And they're going to benefit from the supports and targeted interventions such as the family nurse partnerships, which is about getting alongside young single parents to support them in their journey. I think also we need to look at what more we can do, and if there's more that we can do to support young adults that we're not doing at the moment, then clearly we would want to consider doing that. Claire, I don't know if there's anything more you want to add.
I think you had sort of covered that, Cabinet Secretary, with the exception maybe of the Care Experience Grant. As an annual £200 a year grant that will benefit around 50,000 young people between the ages 16 and 26 who don't have the access to the same family support, family support networks as perhaps some of their non-experienced, non-care experienced peers.
David?
The Minister mentioned earlier a planning process for care leavers and evidence from the committee from Helen Harper of Care Inspectorate. She says the planning process was out of date for care leavers. I wonder if the Minister could expand on her previous answer about how the Scottish Government is going to make improvements to it.
So then Scottish Government, alongside COSLA and many others, our shared ambition is for trauma-informed and trauma-responsive workforces right across the country and for transitions and support planning to be in place for people with care experience. And that's absolutely central to our commitment to keep the promise. As I'd said earlier in a response, I think it was to Gillian Mackay, we're developing trauma training, tailored trauma training that will be rolled out
summer 2023 to the workforce that most closely works with care experienced babies, children, young people and families as part of our national trauma training programme. I think focusing on a trauma-informed workforce right across public services will help not only the general population but also help to support care experienced children and young people.
Other questions?
Bring in Gillian Mackay.
I've heard from constituents about issues around lack of support for young adult carers who do not have access to support granted to young carers, such as the Young Carer Grant, but are often facing many of the same pressures, such as juggling being in full-time education with their caring responsibilities. What action can the government take to better support young adult carers and ensure the transition from young carer to adult carer is a smooth one?
I think the transition period is difficult for young people, full stop. But I think young carers and their transition into adulthood will be even more impacted. We obviously provide a number of supports to carers. Shirley, I don't know if you could perhaps just give a little bit more information.
Certainly, Cabinet Secretary. So we are investing over £350 million in 2023 in supporting eligible and paid carers through the Carers Allowance Supplement and the Young Carer Grant. And work is currently ongoing in the development of the Scottish Carers Assistance, and we'll consult this winter on the proposals there.
Happy to keep the committee informed of that as well. That'd be helpful.
That'd be great. Thank you.
And it's a final call for any last questions, but I think this might be our last question from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you again, Convener. I'm wondering if the Scottish Government, what consideration the Scottish Government has given to offering lifelong support for care experienced people. So we know that very, very often, there's generational trauma, adverse childhood experiences run through the generations there, and the young children especially, really reflect their parents' emotional and mental health, if you like, too. So with it being so important that, young children have a really strong anchor, is it worth considering giving that lifelong support that let's care experienced people know that we really have their back and feel confident that they can go on and become a strong parent and support their child? Thanks.
Scottish Government, as I've said already, is absolutely committed to keeping the promise to care experienced children and young people. We're also committed to supporting them, the young people who are in care or leaving care, and that's enshrined in the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 and in the measures that we've outlined in previous answers. I think collecting data, as we spoke about earlier on from my time in the Health and Sport Committee, that was certainly one of the things that we spoke about often, is collating accurate and relevant data and ensuring that we've got the data that shows us the outcomes for children and young people leaving care, so that we can target our interventions towards them, I think is absolutely key in driving forward the improvements that we want to see within the care service and some of the issues that we've raised earlier today about the whole family wellbeing fund, supporting and providing that wraparound service, that individual support that person needs, I think will be absolutely key to ensuring those transitions occur as seamlessly as we want them to be. We want that flow between services to be as easy for a child or young person and their families as it can possibly be. So certainly our ambition is to work towards the keeping the promises as Scottish Government's committed to.
Thank you very much. I want to thank you both for... Yes, Cabinet Secretary.
It might be a bit cheeky of me, but when you were talking about the cost of living crisis and I referred to supports, it was remiss of me not to plug the moneysupport.scot website with a myriad of supports for people that would really ask members to disseminate moneysupport.scot and the national helpline of 0800 111 4000, where people can get access to find out how they can get help under the current circumstances. So,
well, no, it's not cheeky at all. It's very helpful. And I'm sure we'll all put that on our social media, because that's the sort of thing that people need to know about. So thank you very much. And thank you to you both and to your officials for your time this morning and some very valuable information that will inform our report. So thank you to you both. We're going to suspend the meeting until the next part of our agenda.
Our third item today is an evidence session on two supplementary legislative consent memorandums related to the UK Health and Care Bill. And these are supplementary legislative consent memorandums 6-5A, lodged on 9th of December 2021, and the supplementary legislative consent memorandum 6-5B, lodged on the 27th of January 2021. And to give us some feedback on them, we are joined by the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, Hamza Youssef, and who's online, and he's joined by his officials online as well, Robert Henderson, the team leader for Intergovernmental and International Relations Unit, Jane Hamilton, the head of Directorate Support and Intergovernmental Relations, and John Patterson, deputy director of Food, Health and Social Care from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I believe you've got an opening statement that you'd like to make.
Well, thanks very much for the opportunity, Convener. Can I first of all say that I hope you and all committee colleagues are keeping safe and keeping well. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to take questions. You'll know that the Scottish Government lodged a legislative consent memorandum on the 31st of August for the provisions which extend to Scotland. At the time of lodging and in my appearance at this committee on the 5th of October, I advised that the Scottish Government was not in a position to recommend consent to any of the provisions, despite, and I said this a number of times actually in front of your committee, despite being broadly supportive of the policy intentions. The bill is a skeleton bill. It has 9 Henry VIII powers to amend primary legislation through secondary legislation, and the UK Government's reluctance to include appropriate consent requirements was, to me, a direct threat to devolution. As you may recall from that previous evidence session held in October, I stressed just how important it was to secure the consent of Scottish ministers on devolved matters. It's an integral pillar of the devolution settlement, and our respective officials are currently discussing how parliamentary scrutiny of a decision to consent to any such SIs can be achieved. I was really therefore pleased, and I'm pleased to inform committee that I've successfully negotiated consent requirements for key provisions within the bill. I'm now in a position to recommend that the Scottish Parliament grants consent to the following clauses: the medicine information systems, information about payments, etc., to people in healthcare, in the healthcare sector, that's known as mandatory reporting, food labelling, reciprocal healthcare, professional regulations, the Secretary of State's power to transfer or delegate functions in terms of arm's length bodies, and virginity testing and hymenoplasty offences. These provisions touch upon several different policy areas, and of course I'm always supportive of measures that seek to enhance and improve the health of the people of Scotland. It's, however, exceptionally important to note that the delivery of healthcare in Scotland is devolved, and I will always continue to challenge the UK Government in any perceived overreach into NHS Scotland. I must also notify the committee that I was unable to resolve the competence dispute on the advertising of less healthy food and drinks provision. I remain supportive of any measures that are designed to tackle obesity, but it's with regret that the UK Government maintains that this is entirely reserved. So I'm happy to take any questions that you may have on this.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And you've largely answered my questions, and it's good to hear that there's a lot of their previous concerns have been resolved. And of course, you've mentioned there that the one in particular is still outstanding. And I believe that Sandesh Gohan is going to ask you questions around the advertising aspect of things in a moment. My question, I suppose, is a sort of parliamentary process question to you about where the kind of notice that you were able to give Parliament of any regulations that are made in devolved areas which consent isn't required, and also where consent is required but an SI Protocol 2 does not apply. Where does Parliament sit in actually being able to scrutinise those decisions?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. That's, again, exceptionally important question from my point of view. So we actually start at the basis of my answer. will be that wherever we can include some level of parliamentary scrutiny, we will do that. And I mentioned in my opening remarks that I'm very keen that my officials continue conversations with the committee and the committee clerks and, of course, elected members where appropriate to discuss what that scrutiny will look like. I think we can only it can only be to our advantage to have that scrutiny. In terms of the specific question, so regulations made in devolved areas where there's no consent requirement, so the food labelling provision and reciprocal healthcare provision, they confer concurrent powers on Scottish ministers. The concurrent powers in reciprocal healthcare in relation to regulations made by the UK government, they're subject to the terms of the SI Protocol 2, which you mentioned, and therefore account for parliamentary scrutiny. Where Scottish ministers make regulations, Scottish Parliament will be notified by way of an SSI. The medicine information systems provision includes a consultation requirement that will be underpinned by a robust MOU that outlines the principles of engagement. The MOU hasn't been finalised yet, but my officials are collaborating with UK government to ensure that prior to the drafting of regulations, consultation takes place in a meaningful and timely fashion. And I do stress those words, it has to be meaningful and it can't be last minute. I will, of course, write to the committee then to provide an update upon conclusion of the consultation process. The competence dispute on advertising provision wasn't resolved, and UK government maintain its entirely reserved, so therefore there's no specific requirement for the UK government to consult with Scottish ministers before making any secondary legislation in relation to online advertising of less healthy food and drink. There is, however, a requirement placed on the Secretary of State consult persons that they consider appropriate. And since I consider that the online advertising provisions are at least in part devolved, I will write to inform the committee of any UK government consultation that takes place. In relation to your second question, how do you scrutinise the SG position in respect to proposed UK government regulations that are in devolved areas where there is a consent requirement but SI Protocol 2 does not apply? I don't think that there are any current protocols in place of UK government regulations in devolved areas with consent required, but an SI protocol does not apply. But my officials, I know, they're in discussions with the Scottish Parliament about how parliamentary scrutiny of a decision to consent to any such SIs could be achieved. But I think I would be right in saying that it doesn't apply, we think, in any protocols currently.
Thank you very much. I'm going to hand over to Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Convener. Hello, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, do you not feel that a unified UK approach to unhealthy food and drink advertising would be better than individual?
So, as I said to you in October, I think I've just referenced it in my opening statement, the policy principle is one that I have no objection to. I think there's a lot of good that can be done on a four nations basis around tackling the advertising of less healthy food. But it is, of course, incumbent on me in my position in government, and I suspect it's important for all MSPs that we protect the devolution settlement. And I suppose what we're worried about is there being some overreach. It should be noted also that there are certain stakeholders, such as importantly the Food Standards Scotland and Obesity Scotland, who have criticised the UK government's definition of quote unquote less healthy. So, you know, there can be understandable differences. But again, I stress the point, the substance of the policy is not one that I'm particularly opposed to. It is just the overreach into public health, which I think we could all agree is a devolved matter.
Are there discussions ongoing with the UK government about this, and do you feel we might reach a resolution to get a unified approach?
So I don't think the UK government will necessarily accede to this one. Discussions will always continue, and I should have said at the beginning of my remarks, I'm grateful for the personal intervention of the Secretary of State for Health. Frankly speaking, in my previous meetings and correspondence, we weren't getting very far, and I mean, he and I were able to sit down and thrash it out. I'm pleased that he compromised in relation to the consent provisions that we were reasonably asking for. So I'll keep the discussions going, but I don't, frankly, Dr. Kohani, think that the UK government will change its position.
Thank you.
Can I bring in Emma Harper, who's online?
Thank you, convener. Just waiting for my camera to come on. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just to kind of pick up on what you said about working with the Secretary of State for Health, there's obviously been a lot of work taking place between the civil servants in both governments. And in your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary, you outlined what originally seemed to be that this bill was encroaching on areas that were devolved to the government in Scotland. So are you able to, I guess, tell us a little about the work that has taken place between the two governments to achieve legislative consent so that continued working will take place in the future to make sure that Scotland's devolution settlement is always part of any of these legislative consent motions as we go forward?
I can be relatively brief, and it actually gives me an opportunity to thank my officials who are on the line. They and their teams have worked incredibly hard behind the scenes, trying to ensure that the UK government officials and counterparts can see that we're not being obstructive or trying to be difficult for the sake of being difficult. We had a genuine concern, which when I came to committee in October, I think was not just well understood by committee, but I think there was a lot of agreement around the table that where the substance of the policy wasn't necessarily the issue. The lack of consent in areas that were clearly within devolved competency was of great anxiety. In terms of the discussions that took place, there was quite a fair bit of correspondence to and fro, and meetings and discussions, telephone calls and so on that took place. And as I said to Dr. Kohani, grateful for the Secretary of State, Sajid Javid, for personally intervening. And when he and I had a conversation weeks ago, that is really when we began to see some movement. Conversations will have to continue. There is the unresolved issue, which Dr. Kohani has just asked about a moment ago, and actually on the implementation of a number of these clauses, if the bill passes, of course, UK in the House of Commons, those discussions will have to continue, as well discussions on the MOU, which has yet to be finalised as well, and I would expect to come back to Parliament with a further update on that.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Emma. Can I go to Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you, Convener, and good to see you this morning, Cabinet Secretary. A note from our papers that the Scottish Government have done some significant stakeholder consultation around virginity testing, perhaps most importantly with third sector partners who got expertise relating to honour-based violence or the wider violence against women and girls agenda. And I'm wondering, I'll maybe roll two questions into one so that you can just take it all on board there. So firstly, how will the virginity testing provision be enforced? And then secondly, are there potential risks of criminalising this practice? And if so, how would these be mitigated against? Thanks.
Thanks to the member for the question. I think the second question is really a really, really good one, because it's the first one is also good. Don't let me take that away, but the second one is really important and vital for us to answer. So on the first question, which is perhaps a slightly easier one, like any offence that's created, we'll work really closely with the Crown. Procurator Fiscal Service work really closely with Police Scotland in terms of implementation, and that how we do that, for example, won't be any different to when we create new offences. So we'll take that away in the usual way. I think the second question really is critical and important. So we can't find or are unable to find any evidence of virginity testing taking place in Scotland. Now that is not the same as saying it doesn't happen, but we just haven't been able to find the evidence of it. suppose the criminalisation of this practice, what it intends to do is to ensure a unified approach across all four nations. So although we couldn't find the evidence of it, again, I stress that doesn't mean it's not happening. What we wouldn't want the situation to arise is that the other nations of the UK legislate this as an offence. And of course, Scotland is seen as some kind of safe haven for virginity testing if it was to take place. We just would not want to be in that position because we recognise, although we're unable to find the evidence of it taking place, I think it would be fair to say that all of us would agree, and I'm certain the committee also agrees with this, that of course, virginity testing is a form of violence against women and girls and completely unacceptable if it is happening or where it is happening. In terms of the stakeholder engagement, there were positive the stakeholders in terms of legislating for the offence, given everything I've just said a moment ago. The only kind of note of caution that was perhaps struck, and it was only, I wouldn't overplay it, but the note of caution that was struck was, you know, could we be in danger of over-criminalising offences that are perhaps put focus on Black, Asian, minority, ethnic communities. And the second point that the number of groups made was, yes, to legislate, but you've got to accompany it with education, working with those communities, you know, getting into those communities to of course, eliminate this practice if it is going on in Scotland in any way, shape or form. So actually the feedback and the stakeholder engagement was really good.
Thank you. Bring in Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The supplementary LCM notes that there is a lack of evidence showing that hymenoplasty is in fact being practised in Scotland. Are there any plans to collect more data on this and on attitudes towards virginity in Scotland more widely?
I think the short answer to that is that we should do that because of what I've just said to Stephanie Callaghan. You know, we're unable to gather evidence around whether virginity testing or hymenoplasty is happening. That's not to say that it isn't, because, you know, if it's happening in England, potentially happening in other parts of the UK, I don't doubt that it may well be happening here in Scotland. But that's why I think the second point I was making to Stephanie Callaghan perhaps is quite important. It's really vital that we do this by involving ourselves within the communities where we think this might or could be potentially happening, and working with them and empowering them to root out any of those practices that are clearly, I think we can all accept, a form of violence against women and girls.
And given that these practices often happen in secret, and given the difficulty gathering data on it, is there any plan for an awareness raising campaign around the fact that these are now offences, to ensure that women and girls who may not be aware that they are well informed and know their rights?
Yeah, I think once the bill passes, if it passes the House of Commons, then absolutely. And so, you know, we will do the work on that, and perhaps a four nations basis. It would make sense if the legislation is across the four nations. Though we will look at what the UK government's plans are, perhaps for that marketing, for that awareness raising, and if we agree with it, good. We'll do it on a four nations basis. But sometimes is the case, if it doesn't quite match the messaging that we feel is appropriate, then we'll take forward our own awareness raising. But yes, there will be awareness raising, and as I just keep saying, keep emphasising, I think it's really important. We really want to work with those communities so they don't feel kind of unnecessarily targeted. Whereas, you know, I think people in all communities, ethnic minority communities, would be the first to say that these practices are abhorrent and they have no place in any society.
Cabinet Secretary, I think we've exhausted all our questions. I want to thank you for coming along with your officials to give us an update on this. Our next meeting on the 22nd of February, the committee will receive an update from key stakeholders in the social care sector. We'll also take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on three affirmative SSIs. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.